Welcome, friends, for this afternoon session of day one of our meditation workshop. We now try and practice something that I was talking about in the morning. Step one of good meditation is to go realize our inner self, which will then start meditation. First thing is to realize that we have an inner self which has the same self as we are experiencing now, which has same sense perceptions that we have now, in fact better perceptions, has the same thinking power that we have, and the same life and same feeling of self, identification of the self as we have now. If we can feel that inside our head, then we are ready to meditate. So let's prepare ourselves for meditation. And the step is very simple, that we close our eyes and imagine that in the darkness we see, we are sitting in the head. The head has to be assumed that there is eyes in front, the ears on the side. There is a top of the head, and throat is below us. This is the portion of the head we are thinking of. And we are seated on a chair, like you sit on chairs here, or on the ground, if you like to sit on the ground, right behind the eyes. And you are looking in front. If you can do that, that is a good beginning. You do not have to continuously think of the head once you have focused yourself there and imagine you are sitting there. After that, do not continuously keep on thinking of the head. Think of yourself. Think of who is sitting there. Think of who are you. What do you look like? Look at your hands. These hands are outside. Nothing to move on this outer body. All the movement to take place of the inner self. All the actions, activity of the inner self. So let's practice this for a little while. So please close your eyes. Keep seated where you are. Do not move too much in the physical body so that you do not draw your attention back. Put your whole attention on imagining yourself behind the eyes. To be more sure, to start with, feel that you are as far behind the eyes as your ears are. That means if you draw two lines behind the eyes and draw one line between the ears, that place is where you imagine you are sitting. It's only imagination. There's no pressure to be put on the eyes. No pressure to put on the head. It's not a physical exercise at all. Do not make it a physical exercise by trying to focus on the eyes or something. Nothing. Just close your eyes and feel you are between the ears and experience that imaginative self. And then I will tell you what to do. So close your eyes and seat yourself at what I will now start calling the third eye center. So close your eyes and go to the third eye center. Welcome back here. How many of you could do it? How many of you had a problem doing it? It looks like most of you were able to do it. That's very, very happy. The meditation is to be done by the self you just saw, your form. That's the form that is supposed to do meditation if you want to withdraw your attention from the physical body and the physical world. It's very important. Let us see if you can do more with it in this second practice. In this practice, you will go back inside and after you have established yourself with the center, you forget the head. Don't keep on thinking of the head. It's only the beginning that you have to focus that you are the head. Once you know who you are, the imaginative self sitting there, standing, stepping on each side, once you do that, do not have to come again and again to think there is the head. Unless your mind goes outside into the physical world again, then you have to pull back again to the head. But if you are functioning within that space, after you feel you are there, you can forget about where you are. Don't have to worry about the center or worry about where the third eye center is, where the eyes are, where the ears are. That's only in the beginning. If you keep on thinking, am I between the eyes and the ears and all that, you remain in the physical body. It's only to start that we establish ourselves there. Once you feel you are that and can do all these things, you can do a lot more. And only when you think, where have I parked my car, what have I left behind, is something happening at home physically, then you lose the place. Third eye center stays with you so long as you start from there and forget about the body, forget about the head. You stop. Every activity, even flying 1,000,000,000 miles away, will still be in the third eye center. All activities will be there. But if you start focusing once again on the head, you're back in the physical body. Let's do the next exercise. I hope you will like it. Flying in the sky. How many of you like to fly? Oh, that's a good number. Let's go back. Third eye center. Close your eyes. Welcome back. During these meditation sessions, you might see that I rub my eyes and my face like this, and my hands and my knees, because when you go into deep meditation to get back to body awareness, this helps. So that is why I've just got used to it, and it helps to come quickly back into the body awareness. How many of you could fly? That's a very good number. Who was flying? Yourself. Not your body. It's a better recognition of who is to meditate, not your body, the one that flew. That is yourself, not somebody else. Your own self in that form is to meditate where the starting point, third eye center. You can sit on the floor. You can sit on a chair. You can be comfortable. The same principles apply to meditating with the inner self as they apply to meditating with the outer self. That means sit very comfortably, relaxed, but not too relaxed, so you go to sleep. There's a great tendency to sleep during meditation. That happens because that is how we sleep, actually. You cannot meditate while lying down. You go to sleep. Sleep is a way of going out of body awareness at a lower center. It does not keep you at eye center. Your flight was at the eye center. Your sleep pattern, dream patterns are at the throat center. It's always happened like that. You lose that notional position of where you think you are. Right now, you know where your eyes are, physical eyes are. If I say, can you touch your eyes? You can touch them. Can you touch your eyes with your eyes closed? Yes, you can touch them. You close your eyes and you can still touch them. You know where they are. If you are going to sleep at night, try tonight, when you are sleepy, about to sleep, try to touch your eyes with the eyes closed. You will touch your nose and you will think you are touching your eyes. What does that mean? That means the notional point where you are thinking that you are always behind the eyes is not true. When you go to sleep, that notional position which you are experiencing now is also moving down. So therefore, when you are in sleep with dreams, you have actually gone down to the throat. There are some yogic exercises which I practiced long ago where you can maintain a certain amount of awareness of your being asleep and you are in a dream state. You know it's a dream. When you have that experience, and many of you must have had it, then at that time, if you were to touch your, somebody else would say, touch your eyes. You will, in the dream state, touch your throat, this physical throat, and think you're touching your eyes. When you have dreams, the body also is still connected with the dream because it's all being done within this physical body. Only when you are dreaming, your notional position, which you now believe is behind the eyes, there's no actual being sitting there. It is your own experience. That experience shifts down the throat. When you cross that and go into deep sleep and there's no dream, then you go even further down and you can go as far as the heart center. This is every night we are all doing it. By yogic practice, we can do it deliberately and keep a volition on it, our control on it. But without control, we are all doing it. And the test can already be done. When you want to touch your eyes, half asleep, you will not touch eyes, but a little below that. On the other hand, if you are in meditation and your body is not fully withdrawn from its awareness, then if you were to touch your eyes, you will always touch the same eyes or higher, not lower. So this is a strange thing. Don't forget that when we have the experience like that, we are not leaving the body. We are still in the same body. It's an amazing wonder that we can experience what would happen when we die, when we actually leave the body. The same thing can be experienced without leaving the body. So meditation is a possibility to let us have an experience of dying while living. That is why we can have an entire experience. What would happen if we were to die and withdraw attention from the body and leave the body behind? But in meditation, we get the same experience without leaving the body behind, only withdrawing the awareness of the body, and therefore awareness of the world. So it's a very wonderful method that we have been given, that we can experience death while we are still living and continue to live. You will notice that even if a complete withdrawal of the self, complete awareness is gone, you don't know where the body is. You are flying somewhere. Now when you were flying, right now, you did not know where the physical body was. Maybe little awareness might have crept in to show you you are doing experiment only. If you are regular meditators, you will completely forget where the body is. When you fly back into the third eye center, the body awareness starts coming up and you can open your eyes and feel you are also here. The heart functions normally. Your breathing goes on normally. All vital signs continue normally. They all collapse during physical death. But during this experience, the experience is identical, but the vital signs continue in the same way. This is all happening because just like we have energy centers below the eyes, which maintain all energetic efforts of the body, we have awareness centers behind the eyes and above the eyes. Awareness centers are different from the energy centers. They increase our awareness of our inner self. It's the awareness centers we are opening up. We are not actually leaving the body, but having experiences which would happen if you were to leave the body physically. So if you are able to maintain that and have more experiences of the inner self, you will find that that is exactly what happens when you die. And with practice, you can lose complete fear. You can lose the fear of death completely, because you will know what happens when you die. That exactly will happen what you can practice through meditation. So I'm very glad so many of you are able to do this. Now, to meditate, you can use the method of meditation taught to you. Now you can even use other methods like repetition of words, repetition of mantra. I was virtually throwing it out in the morning and bringing it back in, because it has to be done not by the tongue, but by the inner self, which just flew out, which just sat in their head. That self has to now repeat the words. What is the purpose of repeating words? Is it really that there are magical words which will take us somewhere else? Not really. Purpose of repeating words is to occupy the mind with those words, put attention on the words, so mind is not given enough time to think of other things. Mind thinks in words. Mind thinks in images. All the thoughts that we have are in our language, in words. We're continuously thinking. We are thinking 24/7. The mind is thinking all the time. When you repeat words with the inner self, the mind picks up repeating the word. You are removing yourself from the physical tongue, and therefore you are giving less scope to the mind to think of outside things. Nothing will be a problem in your meditation except the mind starting thinking of other things outside. And that happens mainly because of our attachments. Our attachments create that. And also, some attachments are created by your desires. This is a lifelong thing that we are having desires and attachments. They are the only obstacle to our holding our attention inside. When we try to meditate and stay inside, we start remembering something outside. It is almost like the mind is something separate from us and trying to avoid us from meditating. It looks like the mind is an enemy there. Actually, it is not. It's just a machine. It's just like a computer. The mind is an accessory to consciousness. Mind is an accessory given to us so that we can generate experiences in time and space. So we can think. We can use the mind to think. We can use the mind to rationalize. We can use the mind to make sense of things. We can use the mind to understand that what we are seeing outside, we can give it a name and an identity. When I say, this is a glass of water, what makes me say and believe it's a glass of water? Eyes did not see a glass of water. Eyes can never see a glass of water. Eyes can see the shape, the color, that's it. Eyes only see shapes and colors. The eyeball is not designed for anything more than that. It's only got rods and cones in the retina, which can only identify shapes and colors. If shapes and color doesn't make a glass of water, then what is making a glass of water? It's an association of ideas that the mind has created, that the water that we drink, the experience of drinking water, when that image comes, the mind can say, this is water, glass of water. The mind interprets, eyes cannot see the glass of water, the mind sees the glass of water. Everything that we see or feel or touch or smell, the mind interprets what it is. Therefore, the mind's interpretative function is very strong. We could not have any sensory experience if the mind was not there to interpret it for us. So that is why mind is very useful for having any experience in time and space outside. This is a wonderful thing given to us, a gift. Use the mind to have an experience. Use the mind to interpret it. Use the mind to think about it. Use the mind to communicate with others. Use the mind in the grand drama that we are creating outside. Use the mind. But what happens after some time is that by using the mind, we give it so much power, it becomes a separate identity of its own. And the mind is thinking, we are not thinking. In meditation, this problem will come. You will soon see you are not the mind. You are the self. The mind is not the self. Big discovery, because so far we say, I am thinking. It's a complete identification with the mind. It is as strong an identification as sitting in this body. We say, this is me. The body is me, the mind is me. I am thinking. Not true. I am using the mind to think. That's the truth. How can you say that you are the mind and thinking is yourself? You can easily find that other things happen in life which the mind is not involved. Then who is having that experience? The experience of intuition, experience of knowing something by gut feeling, where no thought is involved, who is having that? If the mind were ourself, then all experience would be of the mind. But we are having experiences of love, falling in love instantly without the mind knowing anything about it, mind questioning about that experience. Who is that? That is the self. The self is having experiences at all times, even in this physical body, even in the dream state. It's having experiences, what we call gut feeling, intuition, love, appreciation of beauty. Things are happening which are not part of the mind's thinking at all. Therefore, our self is separate from the thinking mind, and it's a mistake to identify ourselves with the mind, just as it is a mistake to identify ourselves with the body. This takes time to understand that the part of ourselves that is not the thoughts is more real of ourselves than the thoughts. To understand it better, try to watch out for those experiences where you get sudden information without thinking. For example, there are people who have made a plan to travel by plane tomorrow. I don't know, something tells me I should not go. And next day the plane crashes. Happening all the time. What told us? Who told us? Don't go. And see, some people say, no, no, it's all a superstition, I will go. There is a part of our self far more knowledgeable than the mind. Thoughts come from what is in front of us, what we can reasonably remember over a short period of time. We say, I think I should do this. Next day, oh, I should have thought more. I made a mistake. We do that all the time because the spectrum of information, data we have to use the mind is very limited. You can't remember everything all the time. Yet, the self can remember everything all the time. Intuition does not come from the small spectrum of data that the mind is using. It comes from all or several lifetimes. If you go and study these things inside, in deeper meditation, you can go and actually study the mind, how it is working. And then you will, of course, know you are separate from it. So that is why many of these things that we are experiencing every day have created problems for us by the mind being given an identity of its own, and the mind, we say, we are the self, the mind. We first make the mind an independent entity. It's thinking, so we think that's the being. And then we identify, I am that being. Big mistake. Separate yourself from the mind. I'll tell you a simple trick to do that. If you were to go back to the inner self and do nothing, sit there and watch your mind. Don't think of anything. Just watch the thoughts coming. You will know you are not the thinker. You can watch your thoughts independent of yourself. Would you like to do that? Let's do it now. Let's go back. Let's see if we can watch our mind and understand we are not the mind. Another part of the meditation exercise that will help you in deeper meditation. So go back, close your eyes. Go back to the center of the head. Comfortable, relaxed, in the center, behind the eyes, between the ears, and in that space, then forget the head and the eyes, everything. Just be in that space. Now, in that space, be absolutely quiet. Don't utter a word. Don't think of anything. But just watch what happens. You'll see that thoughts are still coming in front of you, both in words and images. Just watch the show. Watch your mind in action. You don't try to think at all. Let the mind show what it is. No matter how bizarre the thoughts are, just sit quietly. You can smile a little when you get amused at what the mind is doing. Just watch the mind. Welcome back. How many of you could separate from the mind and watch it thinking? I know it's a very difficult task. So many of you did it. I'm very happy. Our identification with the mind is so strong, we have begun to believe we are the mind. That has caused more problem than anything else. Because the mind is a very big troublemaker. And when we say we are the mind, we have become troublemakers for ourselves. If we understand the mind is not ourselves, we are merely watching the mind at work, what will happen? We'll know what the mind is, a useful thing. Let us say thinking. Do we think what we want to think? Or does the mind decide what to think? If you look at our life, the mind was given so we could use it to think what we want to think. Now what's actually happening? Thinking is going on ourselves and we say, yes, that is me, that's me. That's a big problem. We have a will. People talk of will. Willpower. You must have heard, he has strong willpower. When we have willpower, whose will is it? Is it the will of the self, our self, or the will of our mind? We all have two wills. We have a mental will, which is giving the power to will to the mind, and we have a spiritual will, which belongs to the spirit, to ourself. The spiritual will is expressed when we have an intuitive feeling of something, when we have intuition of anything, when we tell the mind to follow what the intuition says, we are exercising spiritual will. When the mind wants to follow its own will, then we are caught up in the mental will. We are all using mental will all the time and ignoring the spiritual will. When the intuitive flash comes into our head, the mind argues, no, that is just the idea, forget it. We listen to the mind. Can you imagine that a machine given to us to use, it's an organic machine, it's a machine of a stuff of thoughts, images, just built into our consciousness, built into our awareness, and we have become the slaves of that machine. Whatever that machine says, yes. What would happen to this physical world if everybody just followed these computers? Whatever computer says, we do it. We'll become slaves of a machine. We are already slaves of a machine by following a computer we call the mind. It functions like a computer. Not very different. So that is why we have to reverse this position. We have to use the mind, not get used by it. Or most of our life is getting used by the mind. Mind tells us what to do. Thoughts tell us what to do. What the next step should be. Thoughts analyze what are the options available, which one should they follow. And we just blindly follow. We should develop our intuitive will, our spiritual will. Not difficult. I'll give you a very simple way to develop intellectual or spiritual will as against intellectual or mental will. Learn to say no to the mind. Not every day, not all the time. 3-4 times a week. That should not be difficult. Say no to the mind when the mind wants something the most. Mind says, I must have it. Say no. Mind says, only once, no. Mind says, never again. Say no. If you can do that only 3-4 times a week, you will find that the one who is saying no to the mind who is wanting something so much is yourself. There's nobody else there except yourself and your mind. In this thinking process, nobody else is there. Therefore, your ability to say no to your mind when the mind wants something very badly develops your spiritual will. It develops your inner will of the self, a real self. Otherwise, we are consistently going with the mind says. And people who are meditating for a long time, many years, they come to me, we can't control our mind. Of course, we can't control our mind. We are almost identified with it. We are thinking mind is ourself. How will you control it? You have to separate yourself from the mind. Have the ability to say no to the mind. Mind speaks to us all the time. It's not something that we have to search for or look for where it is. When you, as soon as you close your eyes, you can hear the mind speaking. Thoughts go on all the time. There was a friend of mine who said his guru taught him how to still the mind. That the real secret is to still the mind, to go into a thoughtless state. Now, my experience is very different. My experience is if you still the mind, you will die. Mind will die if it doesn't stop thinking. The body dies when it stops breathing and stops having a heartbeat. You can hold it for a little while, then it goes. You might hold it for a few minutes. Very few people are able to hold a straight line of the heart and still survive and give us near-death experiences, tell us. Nobody is held up for half an hour, 1 hour or something. So when that friend told me, he has been practicing it for a long time and he can still his mind, which means he can stop thinking, it was something very big for me. I said, I would like to have a demonstration of it. This happened at Harvard University. I was in an apartment and he was living in another apartment. I requested him to come and demonstrate to me how he has learned how to stop thinking. That would be a very big thing if you can still be alive and stop thinking. He said, books tell us, still your mind. Do this. It's the quietness of the mind. When you're quiet, you get enlightenment. All those big words he used. I said, stop the word, tell me how to stop thinking. And he came to my apartment. He said, you have to follow a certain asana. That means a certain position of the body. Lotus position and then takes up arm somewhere. I said, do that when you're ready. When you are ready to stop thinking, it's a very short experiment. How long can you stop thinking? He said, an hour, half an hour. I said, if you can stop thinking for 1 minute, I'll believe you can stop thinking forever. Let's experiment for 1 hour. So he got into the regular position, which his guru had taught him. And I said, to measure that period, I will give you a clap like this. Stop thinking. After 1 minute, 60 seconds, I'll give you a second clap. You can start thinking. Then we will know what happens to consciousness, what happens to awareness when you're not thinking at all. It must be a very strange kind of experience. He said, all right. So he got into his proper asana and I looked at my watch and gave him a clap. I kept looking at my watch. 60 seconds passed. Give a clap. I said, did you stop thinking between those two claps? He said, yes. I said, I have a few questions. And these questions are related to what happens during the 60 seconds. I'm only going to ask you questions about those 60 seconds, what happened. And you have to remember and tell me, not make up an answer. Actually remember what happened when you were not thinking, because that's what I want to know. What happens to consciousness, to our awareness, if thinking stops? I said, first thing is, when I clapped, how did you know it's time to stop thinking? What made you know, now I should stop thinking? Remember what happened. And he remembered. He said, when I heard your clap, I did say, it's time to stop thinking. I said, that looks like a thought to me, even though short one. He said, it was so short, just a few seconds. And then I stopped thinking. I said, okay, let's exclude those 3 seconds. Now the experiment was for 57 seconds. Now tell me, after you stopped thinking, how did you know when the second clap comes, you can start thinking? I said, don't guess. Tell me what happened, actually happened. Remember. And he remembered, and he remembered, and he said, I did think. I did say to myself, and I will not start thinking till he claps again. And that looks like a thought to me also. If it actually, these words happened in your head, it's a thought. I said, after that, when you forgot about this, how did you again remember that you have to still start thinking again? Because the process is continuous. And he remembered that this thought that he's waiting for the second clap to come when he can start thinking never went away. And he put his hand on his head. Oh my God, I was thinking all the time when I thought I was not thinking. I said, do you know why you are saying you stopped thinking when all the time you were thinking? You not only thought you were not thinking, you experienced no thinking. And were telling everybody and telling me, I can stop thinking. He said, I don't know. You have opened my eyes. I said, I'll explain. I'll explain why you felt you were not thinking. The reason was that you think in a certain level. But when we think in a certain level, we do not realize that the mind has more than one channel to think. And a finer voice of the mind keeps on thinking above it. For example, we say we are meditating on mantra, on repetition of words. And we're repeating the words with the mind, and a voice above is saying, are you repeating slow enough? Whose voice is that? It's a little less loud than the main thought. There is a secondary voice above it. There's another channel above it. Not only that, a third channel can be discovered if you're clever enough to watch. His Holiness Dalai Lama came to India as a refugee. As it happened, the government decided that he'll be housed where I was working as the district officer. So it was a privilege for me to receive this holy man from Tibet coming. So when he came, I arranged housing for him in Dharamsala in India, and I took care. We became friends. And I had a Land Rover. He used to love to have a ride with me. He began to learn a little bit of English and Indian language so we could communicate. And this is the subject I would discuss with him. He had two tutors with him, teaching him meditation. He was a young man. And this is the subject we discussed about the control of the mind and how many levels it can think. And he had realized you could have up to 5, 6, 8 levels of thought. Thoughts never stop. They go from one jump from one channel to another. When one is stopped, we think we are stopped, but goes to another channel. You can easily watch yourself how many levels are there. Supposing you block all levels, then an image appears that somebody else is thinking. An image in front. It's also your mind. Mind never stops thinking. But this shifting from one to another level with a different sound of the thought, different feeble sound of the thought. You can imagine, you can try it out, how the mind thinks in so many channels. I told my friend, that's all that happened. That the normal channel you blocked, the mind jumped to another level. What you were saying, this will be the time to start thinking again, was not in the same channel of thought which you're used to. It's a higher channel. The mind never stopped thinking. Then what's the meaning of saying stillness of mind? Why are they recommending stillness of mind and you have to quieten your mind and be quiet and all that? This is a message for us that you can ignore the mind. Be yourself, ignore the mind. Mind is thinking. You can ignore it. You can occupy yourself with something else, like watching the show, like doing something else, not thinking. Ignoring the mind is possible. Stopping the mind, not possible. So let's be practical about it, that if the mind wants to think something, use your intuitive will, your will of the self. You do your job, I'll do mine. You can do more easily if you have practiced separating yourself from the mind. So that is why very important exercise to achieve success in meditation, to separate yourself from a machine that's thinking in us, very useful, and use it to think. Whatever you want to think, put the mind to think there. You use intuition to make your decisions in life, and use the mind to implement them. See how your life will change. So simple. If you are using the mind with limited knowledge and tomorrow it says, I made a mistake, sorry, I didn't know this can happen, I didn't know enough. Instead of relying on that kind of an instrument, use your own instrument of your own self, which knows everything. Intuition is coming from a different source, from your own self. Therefore, a change in your lifestyle of using intuition for decision making and using the mind to implement those decisions will make it much easier for you to be successful in meditation and withdrawing insight. Because then you will know the mind will not be interfering so much in your meditation as it is doing now. That is why I give importance to this aspect of meditation, the ability to separate yourself from the mind. Now, let me explain that what are we trying to achieve and why are we doing it? We are doing it because we are unhappy. If you are happy, don't do it. If you are always happy, you don't need to do it. I have not met any person like that, except those who are meditating and going within. Therefore, there must be a reason how by going within you can be happy and by staying outside you are unhappy. The reason, everybody looking for happiness. And sometimes we are happy, sometimes the little pleasures we get make us happy. Sometimes we win a lottery and we are very happy, then when the people file lawsuits against us, then we are unhappy. Sometimes we are happy, we had a good meal, when we indigestion comes, we are unhappy. All these things happen all the time. The reason for that is, the experience that is built here, in the physical world, and the astral world of imagination, and the causal world of the mental self. These are just words we are using. The physical world, the astral world, the causal world. Why are we using these words? Because the physical experience consists of matter, molecules, atoms, these. We are made up of that physical world. It's an experience. Science says, very interesting thing. Science says that if space is taken out, physics, I was a student of physics in India, doing my Bachelor of Science in Physics and Chemistry. My physics professor said, do you know this whole earth, with the billions of people living on it, with so many animals living on it, so many trees, plants living on it, if the space is taken out, it will become like a football. How is that possible? His explanation was that everything is created by atoms, and atoms are nothing but electrons and nuclei, protons, neutrons. They are moving in space. The electrons move away from the center in an orbit like this, and if space is taken away, they collapse. If they collapse, if all of the space that we have between atoms collapses, it'll be football. Many years later, I came to Harvard University, and a professor of physics was explaining, if space is taken out, it'll become not a football, but a marble. Today they say, if space is taken out, it'll be so small, it'll be a black hole, there'll be nothing within. Then who are we? Are we all space? Apparently we are. Apparently we are electrons flowing around nucleus, which are causing all atoms to be made, all physicality to be made, and we are nothing but space. A particular master, a guru, who has a big following, had a disciple who was holding a high office in the government. I was also holding a similar office in government. That disciple used to come to me to discuss spiritual matters. And he used to say, let us charge our battery. By discussing spirituality, we charge our battery. He would come to charge battery. And then he said, I want my master to meet you. I said, I have my master, Baba Sawan Singh, and I'm very happy. I'm not looking for too many masters. I've seen many masters already before I accepted him as a final master. He said, no, my master is keen to see you. I said, I'll certainly go and pay respects to him. One day he brought the master into my office. And I got up, I greeted him. I said, sir, what brings you here? I could have come to you. He said, I have come to initiate you. I said, sir, I am already initiated by another master, Baba Sawan Singh, great master. He said, that was no initiation. He must have told you, meditate all your life, at the end you will find something. I show you God, the creator, right at the time of initiation. I'll initiate you, you will see God right now. I said, I'm not in a hurry, you know, I'm a very patient person. He said, no, I'll initiate you. I said, all right. If the master is so keen to give me some gift, I'll take it. So he initiated me. He did not stop me from sharing this initiation with anybody. So if you like, I can initiate all of you in there. Are you interested? Those who want to be initiated to see God instantly, please raise your hands. Not many are volunteers for this. No, you won't die. Well, his initiation was very simple. He said, hold your hands like this, which I did. Move your hands like this. Now they are together. Now they are separate. Now they are together. Now they are separate. What is between the hands when they are separate? Ask me a simple question. I said, so far as I can see, there is nothing. He said, that is God. He said, the space between your hands is the creative power of all universes. And I tried to smile inside because I said, what an amusing thing to say, nothing is God. And that would be a very poor definition of God. But at night I realized what he said was the truth. Physics says that, spirituality says that, masters say that, space has created all our experiences right here. He wasn't wrong. That's why I'm giving you the importance of space. When you say space, what space creates is a feeling that we are somewhere and all around is space, and we look up in the empty space and we call it a sky. That's why we have a sky. This sky you see outside, at night is dark. Daytime is bright, sunny. You can't even open your eyes towards the sun. When you flew today inside, you also flew in a sky. That was not this sky. That sky is never dark, nor is it sunny and bright. What would you say that if there's another sky inside us, in which you just flew? Yes, there is. A different space exists when you are experiencing your inner astral self. The word astral has been used because of the inner sky. Astral refers to the sky. So when we say astral body that flew is the astral body. And the sky in which you flew is the astral sky. If we can stay in that state and explore it, you'll see that you can fly as far as you like in a universe that sometimes looks the same as this universe and sometimes looks very different. How is it happening that you can have such an experience? The reason is that the space that creates this physical universe overlaps the space that is created by the inner universe. Both are skies. When you have an infinite sky, in every direction, in the physical plane, in physical matter, if you look in every direction, the space is infinite. It's not a definite number at all. If it is infinite in every direction, what would be the shape of the space? It would be a big, huge sphere, infinite sphere. I'm drawing a model that's not correct because it's too limited. It'd be an unlimited sphere. Can I make a bigger sky than that if it's already infinite? Actually, I can. The inner sky is more infinitely bigger than this one. How does that happen? How is it possible that infinity means completely without limit? And how can there be bigger infinity and a smaller infinity? The secret lies in the fact that when we say infinite, nobody can go to infinity ever. There is a limitation up to which you can go, even in thoughts, even physically. They limit how far you can go, and when you stop, it becomes the limit of your infinity. The infinity to which you can try and go in this physical space is limited by your capacity to go. And that becomes virtually a limit of that infinity. The capacity to go beyond that makes it a larger infinity, and that happens in the inner sky. The inner sky, also another sphere. Physical sky, also sphere. Then there's a third sky. When we meditate with the inner self and withdraw attention from that self. Very big, important next step. That when we can withdraw attention from this body and find an astral self, a self that is self-perception, self that can fly, self that can do everything that the body can do. What about meditating in the head of the inner self and opening up another sky? That sky which you open up by withdrawing attention from the inner self is a different sky. It is a much larger sky than even the inner sky. The limits have gone beyond because the capacity to go into that infinity is increased by flying through it. There is a color of the sky. This color of the sky here It's bluish color because it comes, the blue color can come in different ways. Not a reflection of the ocean or something, some people think. But the inner sky has a different twilight zone, like a twilight sky. It's neither too bright nor too dark. There's no night time there. So it's different. The sky beyond that, the third sky, you can go and have experience through meditating from the inner self, in the inner head, is bright golden sky. People accidentally sometimes see, tell me, I saw golden sky. I said, it was just a pull that your consciousness happened to go there. If you have seen a setting sun in the sky up, you can't see it. It's too bright. But when it goes to the horizon and starts setting, we can see the beauty of the golden orange-colored sky. If you stretch that setting sun and stretch it, make it the sky, that's the third sky you can get into. We call it the causal plane of experience because it's that sky, the golden sky, which is responsible for creating the space and time of all the three regions. When you can study that golden sky, you get to know about these also. Now, this is not an intellectual setup that I'm suggesting. These are experiences you can have. First experience, like you did today, withdraw your attention from the physical body and go to the inner self, which is nothing more than the sense perceptions intact. The sense perceptions are the astral body. They're no separate body. The same body which has physical matter in it, when you withdraw, physical matter is left behind and the sensory systems operate. When you go to the next one, sensory systems are dropped. Perception takes place without sensory perception. You will be surprised that perception does not require sensory systems. You don't need sense perception for perception. We normally perceive something with the mind, and it's different that the same perception can be divided into seeing, touching, tasting, smelling. When you cross the second sky to the third sky, your perception becomes immediate. And you realize it's only for the sake of experience that the perception has been divided into sense perceptions. Very big experience. That sky. So the causal sky, that orange golden sky, is much more infinite. But the most interesting feature which I found is that these three big spheres, a huge sphere of the causal sky, the smaller sphere of the astral sky, a still smaller sphere of the physical sky where we're sitting here, they overlap each other. When two spheres overlap, if you imagine a sphere of space, there's no matter, but space only. Space is very tough, much more tough than any matter. That's why we can send radio signals through space, which we can't send through matter. It's very dense in that sense. This space that we have here overlaps the space. Now, you imagine a circle like this and next circle overlapping it, third circle overlapping that one. This looks like a small fish with the overlap is. With the second overlap is, looks like a bigger fish. The whole of creation can be explained as consisting of the skies and two fish. And when I read in the Bible, Jesus Christ gave two fish to 5,000 or 50,000 people, and people are telling me must have cut them into small pieces and taken from the pond. How far away from truth can you go? Is the whole knowledge of the creation that he gave to two fish. What is the function of these? The function is that while we are the physical being here, we can also be in the astral being. Like we can do through meditation. We are still sitting here and we can have an experience in the astral plane because of the overlap. What happens when a person dies? When a person dies, does he go into the astral plane? No. Person is here, but not in the physical plane. And that's the combination, the overlap existing to hold this kind of life. We call that life disembodied spirits. They are having no bodies. They have just died in the physical bodies, but they are still there in the astral body, which has sense perception. Same bodies you examine, your own bodies. They still stay in that body, still have the same self, still have the same mind, still have the same sense perceptions, but they are alive. They don't die. Nobody dies like this. The self can never die because the self is not in time and space. If time and space disappears, you become immortal. The immortality of the soul has been described so much just because it's beyond time and space. But we can't think outside of time and space, therefore we don't understand immortality. How the soul is immortal because it's not yet created time and space to create mortality. Mortality is created only by the mind at the causal plane. So that is why when you have these experiences, you can also have an experience of two planes at the same time. And after death, the body remains there. Therefore, people say, I feel the presence of my mother. She died, but I think she's still in the house. My house is haunted by spirits. I hear this story all the time. The mother that you love so much, when she is a disembodied spirit, you are afraid of her. What happens? Because she's become a ghost. The people we love, they die, we are afraid of them. Oh, I want to get rid of the spirit. You don't want to get rid of your relatives who died. But that is what happens. We are so much attached to the physical form, we do not know the reality of the real form. If you meditate and discover the reality of your higher forms, you'll never be afraid of anything, but you'll be able to converse with those people who have already died. Help them. Let them go higher, not stop them from going lower. That is why when people ask me, what should we do? We grieve, we cry, somebody has died. I said, you are just pulling those souls back. If they are on a spiritual course, if they are initiated by masters and are trying to move higher, you are only trying to pull them back. Therefore, wish them well. Let them go higher. And when you do that, they are very happy. Otherwise, you pull them down, they come over and over again, do various kind of things to show their presence, which we don't like. So remember, this life is not only this physical body. This is a very temporary life. The life of the inner self, much longer. And the proof of that lies in a very strange phenomenon called memory. I think one day I'll have to talk a lot about memory. What is memory? Because it is memory that creates our notion of time and space. And memory is what makes us feel we have been here, there is a past. If there was no memory, there would be no past. The memory creates a past. When we have a physical body, our memory gets confined to the physical body and physical self. We remember when we were young, the physical body. When you practice going to meditation to the inner self and have the memory of the inner self, you start remembering things which happened 100 years ago, 200 years ago, to yourself, your own memory, not somebody else's. And then you realize, how could you remember something that was not there? This body was not there at all. And you realize the inner self has a much longer life than the physical self. When you go to the causal self, life, you can remember things that happened millions of years ago. It's not that somebody else is remembering. Your memory, the memory of the self through the mind, extends over God. Real proof of the existence of our own self in a past that stretches so far away is through memory. And the memory returns in meditation. Then you go to those levels. Meditation reveals so much to us if done properly and done in a way that the main obstruction, main detraction of sitting in the body thinking this is a reality and we are now responsible for all the things around us, that has to be given up. Therefore, the best way is start from there. I am very happy so many of you could actually start well. Some of you, many of you could fly in the inner sky, and some of you could do even more than that. I know many of you have been meditating for a long time. How to meditate with the inner self to go above? And what happens if we reach the limit of the causal plane? If we reach the limit of time and space, limit of the mind, what happens? Can we meditate any further? No. Sorry. Therefore, sorry, we can't find ourselves by meditation. Because every time we meditate, we do it with an effort which is mind. And when the mind is not there, you can't make any effort. Therefore, you are stuck. You are stuck so badly. I have met many masters who thought that is our true home, the orange sky. They could not describe anything more. Naturally, it's very difficult to describe something without time and space. But to say, I found myself, I discovered the truth, I discovered my true home, not possible by meditation. Has to be something else. What else can take us tomorrow? Will be tomorrow. I'll talk to you about tomorrow. What can take us even beyond our minds, even beyond the causal plane. Thank you very much for very patient listening. Tomorrow I'll also take up some questions. I thought I might have a little time, but I think I've spoken too much, too long. So tomorrow we'll take up some questions. If you have any questions on what I am saying, or questions of what I have not said, you please give it to Jonathan, and I'll try to answer some of your questions. Tomorrow, in addition to dealing with the question of how can we discover ourselves without meditation? What is the actual limit of meditation? And why is it a limit? Why can't we meditate more? These issues I will deal with tomorrow and tell you the way which great master taught. How to go beyond the mind. Thank you very much for your patience.